So the night shift at Snowy 2.0 started like any other, until workers noticed that the tunnel was filling with gas. They were told it was just water vapor and nothing to worry about. But in reality, this situation was far worse. Back in early July, the project faced a major safety issue. A chemical reaction was triggered underground, releasing toxic gas, and this wasn't just some freak accident. Last year, the machine digging tunnels had created a sinkhole, and for the past 7 months, workers had been pumping thousands of liters of grout cement and foam into the ground to stabilize it. Now, that foam was causing the dangerous leak. What makes that even more concerning is that Snowyhydro, the company running the project, never revealed this breach to the public. Instead, they focused on flashy videos and press releases, trying to brush the issue under the rug. The Snowy 2.0 project was meant to be a big deal for Australia, pitched as a nation-building effort. It was initially supposed to cost $2 billion and start producing power by next year. Now that budget's blown out to $12 billion and delayed for at least another 4 years. A lot of this trouble is blamed on the tunnel boring machine named Florence. Florence was supposed to dig a 15-kilometer tunnel under Kosciuszko National Park, but it's barely moved, only 150 meters in. Insiders say this was bound to happen, as warnings were ignored from the very beginning. Let's see why this project has gone so wrong. The Snowy Mountain Scheme, also known as Snowyhydro, is a massive hydroelectric and irrigation project in southeast Australia near the border of New South Wales and Victoria. Completed between 1949 and 1974, it's the biggest engineering feat in Australia's history. The scheme includes 16 major dams, 9 power stations, and over 225 kilometers of tunnels, pipelines, and aqueducts. The water, originally flowing southeast to the Tasman Sea, is now diverted through tunnels under the Snowy Mountains to supply water for irrigation and generate electricity for the Australian Capital Territory, New South Wales, and Victoria. Snowyhydro provides crucial water flows to the Murray-Darling Basin, which supports much of Australia's agriculture. It also generates significant amounts of water, taking advantage of the steep elevation drop of over 800 meters to produce electricity through large hydroelectric power stations. In 2017, the Snowy 2.0 project was introduced, aiming to expand the scheme's capacity. Initially, it promised to invest $1.5 billion and be done by this year, adding 2,200 megawatts of power to the grid. Snowy 2.0 would bring the total output to 6.3 gigawatts and give enough storage to power 3 million homes for a week. Interestingly, the idea for Snowy 2.0 wasn't born in a government office, but at a pub in Cooma. During an energy crisis, two Snowyhydro execs came up with a plan while brainstorming over a beer. They sketched out the concept on a coaster inspired by an older blueprint to expand the original Snowy scheme. What started as a conversation in a bar soon spiraled into one of Australia's most ambitious projects, but not without its challenges. The initial budget did not last long. By 2018, estimated cost had more than doubled to around $3 billion, and as of now, it's grown even further. Both Snowyhydro's board and the federal government were warned early on that they had underestimated costs, timelines, and the environmental damage, particularly to Kosciuszko National Park. What began with a $2 billion estimate in 2017 ballooned to $12 billion this year, and that doesn't even include the cost of transmission lines through the Hume Link and VNI West, which could push the price tag to over $20 billion. That's 10 times the original estimate. Pumped hydro is not new technology. It's been around since the 70s. Australia has had three smaller pumped hydro stations, but their impact on energy storage has been minimal at best. Snowy 2.0 is on a much larger scale, however, featuring 27 kilometers of tunnels, making it much more complex and quite the expensive challenge. Even smaller projects like the Kidston Pumped Hydro Station in Queensland are facing delays and cost overruns, and they're nowhere near as massive as Snowy 2.0. The challenge with these projects is that each one's unique, so we can't apply the same lessons to the next. Meanwhile, battery tech is rapidly evolving. Unlike pumped hydro, batteries are getting standardized. They're cheaper to make and easier to deploy. They require lower capital investments, and the payback is faster. So, why did we get it so wrong? Snowy 2.0 project was likely driven more by politics than by sound technical or economic reasoning. The original Snowyhydro scheme was a symbol of post-war nation building, and Snowy 2.0 got framed in the same light, but it ignored the rapid advancements of renewable technology, like better solar panels and batteries. Given these advancements, it might have made more sense to focus on quicker, cheaper solutions like solar panels on warehouse rooftops and smaller, more manageable storage systems closer to where power is actually used. Instead, we opted for a distant, risky, and expensive megaproject before addressing simpler and more practical alternatives. Another one of the major issues is that snowyhydro hasn't accounted for the necessary transmission upgrades that'll make the project work. Transgrid, the owner of the electricity grid in New South Wales, has proposed several options to extend the grid, including connections to Sydney, with costs hitting nearly $2 billion. But that's just the start. Massive extensions to Melbourne will also be needed, and those haven't even gotten priced out yet. There's also a big concern that Snowy 2.0 could actually increase greenhouse gases. While snowyhydro and the federal government claim the project will support renewables, the reality is not that simple. For the next couple decades, it's expected that Snowy 2.0 will store coal-fired electricity rather than renewables. The plans for Snowy 2.0 to pump water uphill when there's an abundance of wind and solar, taking advantage of low electricity prices. But wind and solar don't wait around for Snowy 2.0. They produce electricity when the resources are available. Snowy 2.0 was meant to be the storage solution for renewables, ready to generate power when needed. Snowyhydro claimed it could produce electricity at full capacity, 2,000 megawatts, about 175 hours straight, which is roughly 1 week. But in reality, the max pumped hydro capacity it can deliver is less than half that. The problem lies in how long it takes to refill the upper dam and how long the existing dams need to be empty to run Snowy 2.0, leading to wasted water and lost electricity pollution. There's also serious environmental concerns. The project involves tunneling between two reservoirs, which inadvertently connects rivers and creeks, posing a major threat to native wildlife. The stock Galaxius, a critically endangered fish, is at risk of extinction if climbing Galaxius from the other reservoirs reach its habitat. Additionally, invasive species like the redfin perch and eastern gambusia could spread, threatening native fish populations in major river systems. Snowy 2.0 also risks polluting the pristine waters of the Snowy Mountains. 4 million tons of excavated rock will be dumped into reservoirs, potentially releasing acid-forming minerals and other harmful substances. Past dumpings of similar rock had disastrous consequences, wiping almost all fish in the Tuma River after rainfall. Despite these risks, the alternatives to Snowy 2.0 were not seriously considered. Australia's got thousands of potential pumped hydro sites, and alternatives like chemical batteries and more flexible storage solutions or just better solar configs could have provided energy storage at a fraction of the cost. These options would have fewer environmental benefits, lower transmission costs, and could be implemented much faster. Given these issues, many think Snowy 2.0 should be put on hold. Independent experts need to scrutinize the project before it goes forward, because the stakes are simply too high to risk getting it wrong. Whatever the cost, the government's determined to see Snowy 2.0 completed. It's now expected to be fully operational by late 2028, with its first power generation starting in late 2027, slightly ahead of the revised 2029 deadline announced earlier this year. The project's capacity has also been bumped up by 10% to 2,200 watts, up from the originally planned 2,000 megawatts. The government's recently renegotiated the agreement with Snowy 2.0's main contractor to reset this project. This shift comes as the original 2017 estimate of $2 billion and a 2021 completion date have long since passed. Snowy 2.0 is now billed as crucial for stabilizing Australia's national energy grid, particularly as coal-fired power stations are getting phased out. The Australian energy market operator points to Snowy 2.0 as a key player in improving grid reliability. They've warned that delays could lead to reliability issues, especially as the grid faces pressure, possibly as soon as this summer, with a need for rapid investment in both power generation and transmission. While it's the largest renewable energy project currently under construction in Australia, Snowy 2.0 has been plagued by issues. One of the three giant tunnel boring machines at Florence hit soft sand late last year, stalling just a few hundred meters into what should have been a 15-kilometer tunnel. Though this problem's been addressed, the company's still waiting for environmental approvals to resume work. The federal government's putting the blame for these delays and cost blowouts on decisions made by previous coalition governments. They argue the project got rushed with immature designs, leading to unforeseen complexity and expenses. Despite the setbacks, the government insists Snowy 2.0's importance to the energy grid justifies its rising cost. As part of the project reset, the government's moved away from the fixed-price contract model, renegotiating deals with Snowyhydro's lead contractor. Now the contractors will operate under a target cost model, with incentives for meeting deadlines and penalties for missing them. Critics like Shatter Energy Minister Ted O'Brien argue this shift could burden taxpayers with uncapped costs. However, Energy Minister Chris Bowen defended the decision, saying keeping the old contract metal could only lead to further delays and an even bigger price tag than the current $12 billion estimate. In Bowen's words, "We stand by the project. It remains an important project, but it has not been well delivered up until now. The government is focused on ensuring Snowy 2.0 gets done, despite its troubled history, because abandoning it would be far more costly in the long run." Let's just hope that's true. We are committed to releasing 2 videos a week. Like, share, subscribe, and hit that bell icon for more visionary builds.